Hey there, product launchers. Brenda, Crimi, and I decided to team up today to talk about seasonality, holiday season planning.
Woohoo!
Woohoo! Yeah, I mean, as you can see, it's a little warm for both of us here. We're on the West Coast, and it is summer, and we're talking holidays, but why not? Christmas in July, right?
Oh, love it.
But it is so critical that you start your planning early. And now, for many of us, that planning actually happens like October of the year before the holiday that you're planning. So we would have done holiday, I would say early planning, like thought process on what colors, materials, designs, things like that. We would have started October 2017 for this holiday. And I shared with you this week, my color palette, but that's when I developed the color palette, was way back then. And so, and then we usually start our inventory planning in January, because you sometimes want to get those orders in so that they immediately follow Chinese New Year, depending on the lead time of the product.
Right,
and that's just the bigger the orders when you're in mass market, you need to have them planned in so that your POs or your purchase orders. For those not in the lingo here, I got to remember to keep defining. We are putting in a glossary though, for those of you who are
cool.
What the heck does that mean? What's SKU? And many of you have pointed out to me that we've spelt SKU wrong a few times in our blog post because our team, my team, did not understand that that was not a word, that it's SKU. and I didn't catch it everywhere. So if you find one, let me know and I'll fix it. So we're going to put a glossary in place because there are these terms that go around. But the point is that we would place purchase orders in January. Like that would be the last opportunity. And usually they would follow up, but that made it so that the factory could immediately come back from Chinese New Year and start to plan how they were going to achieve the volume necessary. So it gave them planning time as well. It wasn't like they started on the orders immediately. They usually started on them, you know, in the spring to late to early summer, like right about now, they'd be really in full production for it. But it meant that they had the planning time so they knew how many workers they needed, how much materials they needed. They could plan all of that. So that really is so important for you to make sure that you've got in place. And so let's talk about it from your perspective though, Brenda, because the planning cycle for doing e-commerce is a little bit different and you have a little more flexibility in timing usually because your volumes are tremendous. So talk a little bit about how you've handled that in seasonality.
You know, thinking about Christmas as a seller versus a buyer is a whole different thing. You know, when we're thinking about Christmas as celebrating as a purchaser, we're like, we're not thinking until Thanksgiving unless you're really ahead of the schedule and
really
you're
a planner.
Organized. I had a friend that did that anyway, that's a whole nother story. But anyway, I'm gonna go down that road. But when you're selling products, it's a whole different, you're thinking months and months in advance. And I will tell you, the very first time, now we're all e-commerce, so I'll speak specifically to the e-commerce world, but the first year that we started selling online, it was like, holy cow, what just happened? We missed out on so much money because we didn't know how to plan. We didn't know what to expect. So hopefully we'll touch on some bases here.
Let's mention that real quick. Just kind of encapsulate that, because that's what this is kind of all about. And so if it's your first year doing it, it's so much harder, right? I mean, it is and it's still hard even when you have a new product that you're bringing out you don't know how much better it's going to do in the fourth quarter, but you start to get a sense of, I'm going to call it percentages. So in other words, you have an idea that I have a product, and unless it happens to be a summer specific product or it's its own season, and that's fine. You would know then the season would be from, you know, May to August or something like that. So it's the same thing as having a fourth quarter. It's just set into a different time frame. So think of it when we're talking seasonality, it could be a different season for you.
Right.
How much percentage, Brenda, would you say like the fourth quarter does compared to your other quarters?
So our total year, 40% of our business happens in the fourth quarter.
And sometimes it's more for some businesses and some categories.
Absolutely. And at some point in our call, we're going to switch over and show you some Google Trend things. And so you can kind of help decide on your own product if you haven't had a prior fourth quarter to evaluate and compare it to. So when you have a new product, you kind of have to go by industry standards, so to speak. But typically, you're going to sell 2 to 3 times more at Christmas time than you would on a normal basis. So it's a delicate balance in trying to plan your inventory, because you have a lot of cash outlay of products sitting there waiting to be sold. And so you've got some money tied up in that. And so people need to plan for that, because what will happen is if you don't plan and you're behind the eight ball and you're trying to catch up, what's going to happen is you're just going to lose revenue. And that's the worst place to be if you're trying to sell.
It makes you really mad as a seller, doesn't it?
It makes you really mad. So some of the timing things that you had talked about, specific to Amazon, because that's a big part of e-commerce. So I'm going to talk, about Amazon. When the fourth quarter hits, all heck breaks loose. And it isn't just in Amazon. It's with all the logistics, the ports, the UPS, the delivery trucks. I mean, everybody is managing fourth quarter and fourth quarter volume. So what you believe is the most important product, your own product, may not be UPS's or Amazon's most important product. So
the ports
ports. What, there was one season where there was the strike that happened, there's just all kinds of things that can happen. So it's better to be prepared. So time-wise though, Amazon, it's our goal to have our product into Amazon for the fourth quarter by the beginning of November. We are shipping our products to Amazon. Now, Amazon typically takes, we like to say, about 7 days to check in. Sometimes, we're here in Arizona. Sometimes Amazon tells us to send our product to the East Coast. So there's a few extra days in shipping. And if it's a busy warehouse that it happens to be shipping to, we might experience 2 or 3 days delay before it's actually checked in and live. So when we work with our clients, we tell them to allow at least a 7 to 10 day on the worst end to get that product to Amazon and check in. So if you're shipping out to Amazon the beginning of November, if you follow that 7 to 10 day rule, you're looking at the second to third week of November before that product is checked in and live. Because remember, you're not the only one sending in product. The whole nation is now sending their products into Amazon. So once you hit the middle of November, things start ranking up a little bit. Ramping up is the word I'm looking for. Things start ramping up a little
bit. So this year, just looking at the calendar, so Thanksgiving is the 22nd of November. So when you look at the full weeks of it, that's halfway through the third full week of November. So
yep.
You're at, you really probably wanted to be there no later than the 12th, I would think. So that's,
exactly.
So that really, you may want to start making sure that you're shipping in the end of October.
Exactly.
At this stage.
Exactly. So that the November 1st is kind of our cutoff. We want to make sure all of our products are sent in by the beginning of November. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't send product in after the fact, but we want to send enough product that gives us a big enough cushion if sales take off more than what we anticipated, that we still have another 2-3 week window to get things going. So on the backside of that, sales start, I think it was December 18th last year, 19th, before they cut off and stopped guaranteeing that Christmas delivery.
Right, so, and sales drop off tremendously on that. And I'm going to anticipate based on that, because Christmas Eve is a Monday. So I'm thinking that they probably will cut off like the 20th or 21st at the latest. I think the 20th is probably the day.
And on top of that, it isn't just Amazon may give you the comment that they're not going to guarantee, but then you still have UPS and all the other carriers in play, FedEx, and what are they doing? Are they behind? So even though Amazon's telling their customers we're going to guarantee it, FedEx and UPS may not be able to pull that agreement when it comes down to it. So the e-commerce world is a little bit different when you're the supplier of those products. So keep in mind, also, when it's the juggle is how much do you want to pay for storage with Amazon? So Amazon throughout the year they charge 69 cents a cubic foot for storage of their products. The fourth quarter, it goes up to $2. I actually have it written $2.40 per square. So to give you an idea what that might cost, a shoebox, normally costs like maybe like 21 cents a month to store in Amazon. When you get that up into, I didn't do the math ahead of time. But at $2.40, you know, you're looking at, I probably, I think $1.42 or something like that, or seven. Anyway, it doubles.
It starts to add up.
So you're sitting here bouncing. It's like, okay, if I send the product ahead of time, I may be spending more in my storage fee. But you don't want to be stuck behind the eight ball either and not having enough inventory.
Especially if it's going to take 7 to 10 days to check it in. So if you ran out, shipped
it. It would cost you far more.
Right.
In lost revenue.
Yeah. Absolutely. So you got to really balance that and be thinking about that and have a sort of quick response as you start to see the sales. And you watch it every single day during the holidays, right?
Oh. Absolutely. And then on the back end, you had mentioned about, you know, the Chinese New Year. So for us, we put our orders into our manufacturers overseas in December. Right. So that we accommodate our orders to do volume through March, because you don't know what kind of backup's going to happen, when you're going to get your product. So it's always better to give that little bit of a cushion.
So, right. So here you are busy worrying about what's selling on Amazon and worrying about the transaction, and you're worrying about all your planning that you're going to have to do for the first quarter of the year, the following year, because you've got to get your orders in with your factory. So you've got lots going on at this time of year. It must be, it's incredibly stressful.
Yeah, it could be, but I tell you, you know, the dip in the summer, it's like waiting for Christmas. Come on, Christmas. I'll take that stress over the stress of, where are the sales at? Where are the shoppers?
That's right.
And come by.
Right. Well, we're going to do a very big special on Chinese New Year planning right before October, because I think that's the best time for everyone to really start thinking about it, because that's when we usually do our planning for it, so that when you hit the holidays and you're placing those orders, you know what you're going to do already. So we start our planning process back in October. And if you're developing a new product that needs to be done either post Chinese New Year or before, we've done that in the summer. So like it's, you know, so you're going to plan it. So we're going to talk about that more in detail, but you're right that both things cascade at the same time. So now talk a little bit before we go back into the trend side, because I want to get to that. But tell me a little bit about that selling period, because like we hear, so, you know, Black Friday is better at mass market retail, Cyber Monday, but what have you seen across the board from the sort of selling patterns?
Well, you know, it really kind of depends on the individual brand and their business model and what their goals are. I mean, if they want cash flow, then certainly put the products on sale for these crazy discounts, and you'll see the cash flow for your Black Fridays and your Cyber Mondays and things. There's plenty of volume, even if you don't discount your product, if you're fairly priced, you know. So our strategy hasn't been about cash flow. It's more about sales volume. So we don't typically put our products on sale in the Black Fridays and the Cyber Mondays. And so we don't see that spike in sales, but we still realize a huge jump.
Because there's more people shopping, right?
Exactly.
So you're going to see the bump in that.
Exactly. Now, if your business model is such where you want to move a lot more product and you want, you know, you're okay with that, then you absolutely are going to leverage and see volume through Black Friday and Cyber Monday.
So you've done that before where you sold a seasonal item. You sold gift boxes that were available only in the fourth quarter, basically. I mean, you had them all year round, but you were basically promoting them to get through them. How did that work? Did you do a different strategy?
We really didn't. I mean, it really comes down to the business model and what your strategy is as far as cash and pros. I mean, if we wanted to take less volume or less revenue, then we could have put them on sale and moved them faster.
Less profit, you mean?
Less profit is the, yes. Exactly.
So you opted to keep your profitability where it is and then maybe have a slightly less revenue than you would have had, but your profitability is higher, so it makes a more sustainable business overall.
Exactly. And one of the things that's a little bit more of a struggle, though, too, is managing the inventory through this process. So, yeah, we could sell the heck out of it, but then would we have sold out and then not had, you know, so there's a fine line in managing the balance of, you know, this is how much inventory we have. This is how much that we can move. This is how much we can get to you. This is how fast we can replenish. All those different strategies come into play. then it's the play of, like I spoke to a little bit earlier, it's like, okay, how much money do you have to invest in inventory that's going to sit there for 60, 90 days before you even see it moving?
Right.
So, I mean, there's all that strategy that comes into play. So absolutely, do the sales work? Yes. But also know that there's a process in managing it. It isn't just, woohoo, I've got cash flow. Well, what's that going to do on the back end to your inventory? I mean, your numbers, all those different.
So let's back up a little bit farther in the timeline process then. So the reality for you is that you're placing orders in the summer, which you know is your slowest revenue time of year. So
right.
That's got to be a serious issue for you in terms of cash flow planning just to support enough inventory to go. So you've had to back up even further to reserve capital for that.
Exactly that, exactly. And so backing up further, we're placing orders in August for inventory to arrive by October at the latest so that we can get our shipments in and get them, you know, planned. So depending on the product and the volume and so forth, yeah, it ties up a lot of cash because you're still needing the inventory. It's like things don't stop. So you could either maintain the status quo or you can put it into play. Maybe you have a marketing plan that you really want to kick it up and get it up and ranking before the fourth quarter so that you realize even more. So then you've got marketing dollars in play. You've got additional inventory in play. There's all part of that mindful strategy. You really have to put the numbers down and be conscious of them and budget for it.
Yeah, it's such a numbers game, really, in a sense that you really, it requires so much planning, so much thought. And so you have the benefit of having done it for, you know, when you've done it for a couple of years in a row and you've got like a, okay, now there's a pattern emerging. I see that. But when you don't, this is where the trends happen. So share with us how you do that when you're sort of planning a new product or helping your clients with a new product category that you've never done before.
Yeah. So it's like planning seems to be the key that we're talking about here. And so planning, especially if you don't have prior years sales tracking to compared to, we love Google Trends. So I want to show a place here. I want to show some samples on Google Trends. So I'm going to share my screen here. And before I do that, let me actually pull up Google Trends. So that's what you're looking at. Because nobody wants to see my
Nobody wants to see screen. No. I know. I'm always like, what's on my screensaver? Oh, no.
Oh, wait. Let me be clear on this. So let me close Facebook. There we go. Okay. So one of the things, if you're a product,
gotta love that the example sitting there is Taylor Swift and Kim Kardashian. Like, we don't have.
Yeah, exactly. So one of the things I wanted to show some examples of some products that really are flat during the holidays that really don't experience a fourth quarter. Then there's products that, like you said, their fourth quarter is really during the summertime and things like that. So use Google Trends as kind of your benchmark to kind of to help plan for your inventory flow. So I came up with the idea of motor oil. I'm like, what cannot really have a fourth quarter? And so I'm like, motor oil probably is not one that has a fourth quarter. And so something that in products that will be affected by fourth quarter sales are gift giving products or products that are themed for the holidays or winter. So I like to look at when I go into, so I just went into Google Trends, I typed in motor oil as my search term, and I'm just going to change it to, I want to see the last 5 years of history going on here. So this is going
to And just to be clear with everyone, this is showing search interest, okay? It's not showing sales, it's showing search interest of people Googling something about motor oil. Now they might be looking for the right motor oil for my, you know, Ford Mustang, whatever it might be they're looking for, but motor oil is in the search term.
Absolutely. I believe that it loosely translates into demand. So I think that, so when you're looking at this line, obviously there's some ups and downs and things like that through the year, but it stays pretty consistent. There's no huge spike. Like, see, this is December. You don't see a big, huge spike in December. So this is an example of a product that's pretty consistent along the way. Google Trends is we also use when we have an initial product that we're exploring to see if it's on an upward trend, if it's a low trend, you know, if it's already hit its peak. So we like to initially do our product search in Google Trends too. But for the point of today, this is a great way to see what the seasonality of your product might be if it's not obvious to you.
So something to note, what you're seeing here is actually the overall search trend time on Google right now. So this is pretty indicative. So there's always a summer dip in it looks like this hill kind of thing, right? There's always a summer dip because people are busy and not necessarily Googling as much as they would be otherwise. So they're on vacation, they're doing something. And then we see that same thing drop off at the holidays where they're just a little busy, right? You know, between Christmas and New Year's, going on vacation, going skiing, whatever, and they're not Googling all day long. And so you see dips at those times of year across every word. But if you were seeing something that was a spike in interest, you'd see a bigger spike here.
Right. So let's go with copper mugs. Let's look at copper mugs in comparison. So let's switch it to our 5 years so that you can see it more clearly. What's going on for the holidays? This one's fun. These are like ski slopes.
Woo-hoo! Oh yeah. Woo.
So what that tells me is that it stays pretty consistent throughout the year, but then at December, look at the huge spike. So that would tell me if I was selling copper mugs, I'm like, oh my gosh, look at the huge spike that I see in the holidays. This is a gift-giving product, right?
Yes.
So you'd want to accommodate that.
Gotta wonder what happened in it looks like maybe August, September of 2017. Must have been in the hot drink item or something.
Yeah.
Because you got a little spike in 2017 that's before December. So.
Oh, right there. I see what you're saying.
It's August. Yeah. That's what I was thinking. It's August. Mm-hmm. Some summertime spike. It must have been featured on the Today Show or something.
good point. Yeah. Okay. So look at something like pools, for example. So this was something that we talked about. You said you mentioned your fourth quarter may be a whole different season.
That's right.
Beach towels. Look at that.
Woohoo.
Right. So December is your low point in pools. So they're not even something people consider it giving for, you know, gift ideas and things. So these are obvious, the point of doing these was so that you could really see an obvious difference in these trends. Right. So I'm going to do one more and then let's do Christmas stockings. That one's just really fun.
Which you would expect to be fourth quarter.
So. You would expect to be. So you'll see an extreme other side of it where it's like flat, 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 and whoop, it's Christmas.
Yeah.
So, you know,
So where does it start on there? So let's sort of look at that. So August, September, people start thinking about it.
And that's pretty consistent with what we see in sales throughout the year. We pretty much, you know, we have different dips and things, and other products, you know, luckily are coming up when other products are seasonally dipping. But overall trend, we'll start seeing September, October is when the climb hits. Sometimes see that low at lull.
That's a really good strategy thought process, Brenda. So I want to break that down just a little bit to be thinking about, because look at here, you're October 12th to October 18th. This is where it's starting to go on the incline. So being the first product in, so if you've got a new product or you're new in the category, this is the time for those people that you might hate, the ones who make lists and do planning and do research prior to the holidays about what they're going to buy. This is where they start shopping. And so they start in the month of October and they're looking for deals, but they're also looking for the right gift or the right product or the right thing. And so they're out there searching. And so to start showing up in search terms in that time and have some product in already may be a tremendous early entrance strategy for you to get picked up. The other thing is that those of us that write articles about the best holiday gifts, we're writing them in October. So if your product doesn't even show up till November, it's too late. We won't see them.
Yeah, and there's a strategy too. If you're a new product that you're launching, specifically again around Amazon is all about the ranking. So if you're ranking up in the top pages, you get the exposure, you get the sales. So when you're a new product, it's really hard to launch in the fourth quarter because your sales are in comparison with established products. So you're a new product that's only maybe getting a handful of sales, and you're competing with these others that have traction and exposure that are now tripled and quadrupled in sales because of a holiday. You're fighting an uphill battle. So certainly launching in the fourth quarter can be can be profitable, and it can be, it's not, I'm not necessarily discouraging it, but what I'm encouraging is realistic expectations of what can happen. So, the good news is the shopper volume has, you know, increased, I don't know, quadrupled, doubled at least. So the chances of you getting sales are good, but I wouldn't set the expectation that as a new product that hasn't begun ranking and hasn't had an initial marketing strategy that's played out to realize triple and quadruple the sales that month.
So the strategy is probably not to launch at that time, but to do it sooner so that you build up that ranking and you do what you can in there. But also then you also have a better expectation, because look, if you're going to do 40% better than you've done in the prior quarters or the prior months, then you could be looking at that and saying, okay, I need more inventory. Here's how much I can plan. At least you have a baseline, even though you've not sold through the season before. So you're thinking about that.
Absolutely. And I would even say, I would even go to the point of not saying don't launch. I would not do a big marketing campaign. I would do a soft launch. And so what that would look like is at least get your listing up, put it on the platform, because it still may get exposure because of the volume, sheer volume of shoppers, and maybe just do some real low level sponsored ads, because you'll get an idea of how the consumer is responding to your product and maybe get those first initial reviews and things like that. So I wouldn't avoid launching. I wouldn't avoid putting your product up and selling it. I would avoid a big launch and marketing.
Going deep on inventory and things like that.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Now that's a very good point. So is there anything else you wanted to show us on Google Trends?
No, I think that the point was made, but it's a great tool to use to help predict your product and the seasonality.
Drop us out of sharing. So
that's what I'm
saying. So we can see your face.
Not sure. There you go.
Wonderful. So I think that's a great tool. We look at this overall too when we're talking, when we're trying to figure out timing. So when we have something that is a summer product, we want to start seeing when the start of the trend is, because we want to make sure that because there's always delays in a new product launch, as you know.
Always.
There's always a delay, and there can always be delays, and we'll talk about that minute when you have manufacturing issues because of capacity at the holidays time, you know, at the planning time. I know, not your favorite subject, I know, but we gotta mention it. So, you know, so we look at that, and so that's where I always like to be at that front end of it, because that gives me a little bit of that buffer room. And if I get in there early, then you're just exposed to those early adopters, which is actually really great, because they will spend a little bit more time going deeper in the listing than picking the first thing, because they're not impulse shoppers. They're not, I got to get in, I got to get a gift, and I got to get out. So we're recording this, and it's Father's Day week. And so I put together a Father's Day article that gave my best things to basically buy last minute 3D printing so that you could download it and print it yourself, right? And because you waited till the very last minute. And ironically, as I was writing it, I was rapidly ordering Tom's gift on Amazon to make sure that it arrives in time.
You were one of those.
I know. I was like, darn it, I forgot about Tom. No, I didn't totally forget.
Wait, is that this Sunday?
Yeah. Oops. Mm-hmm. Anyway, yeah, I know. So,
Can you
buy two
Toms and send me one, please?
Yes. Steve needs the same thing. I'll have him bring it with him.
The buddy method.
There you go. But, you know, this is what happens. So, like, we all get into that last minute, and we will pick the thing that's on the first page when we're doing that. But if you're an early shopper, if you're a planner, if you're researching it, those people will go a little bit deeper, and it gives you an opportunity to be seen and to have your product actually evaluated by somebody who's interested. And so that could be really good for your brand development and your growth overall. So that's a great point, Brenda. But it requires a lot of planning.
Yes. You know, I want to just touch on this light bulb moment I forgot to mention when you asked me the question about kind of the strategy and things about marketing and so forth for fourth quarter. Stocking stuffers are huge, obviously. Yeah. So capitalize on those keywords if your product, in fact, can be utilized as a stocking stuffer, and maybe change up one of your images on your listing to look like in a stocking, so that you're planting the seed. And the messaging I want to reiterate in that is shoppers will shop from the images before they read the bullet points. So don't just put it in your bullet points and your back office keywords and think you're going to get the information across. Put it in an image. So when that shopper's this scan, I'm like, oh, this is a great idea, especially stocking stuffers for men. I mean, we're always looking for unique gift ideas for men. So capitalize on those words.
Yes, yes, so important. And another thing that I want to mention is that this is an important reason to be to start to consider your package design as well, because, you know, this is the thing at this time of year. Yes, it's easy. Amazon lets you throw them in the little sacks and you're going to get a gift. And I've got a huge amount of them here at the house, so I don't need to do any wrapping this year. I'm just going to stick them all in Amazon bags. And so, you know, but if your package is not conducive to wrapping, it annoys people. So, you know, it's these odd shape, like, yeah, it just doesn't, it does annoy people. And they're like, now I got to get a gift bag, you know, if they didn't order a gift wrapping from Amazon or whatever. So, mm-hmm. you know, just be thinking about that, is that if you don't really have it friendly, or if you've been thinking about redoing your packaging, time for fourth quarter to make it gift friendly is a great idea. And it gives you a good reason to update that listing at that time and show the new packaging. And so it's a good reason to be doing that. If you've already been thinking, I need to do this, that's a good time of year to do it.
Yeah. Or showcase it in a basket, you know, because people love creating gift baskets.
That is. And that's also another reason to be thinking about. So let's talk about, because I know you're a big fan of bundles. I love bundles too. Bundling. So this is the thing. It's like when you can make a shopper's life easier by pulling together items that they would already naturally want to buy, you know, it is great. Amazon pops up and you buy a certain item and it says, oh, and people who bought this also bought this, right? And it shows you what you might want to put together. But if I had one place in which I could get it all together all at once, wouldn't that be better? That would save me a lot of time, energy, and people will spend more because they didn't have to work that hard. And this is the other thing. It's like when you're at a last minute for a gift, right? You're concerned if you order these five things from all the different places, or three things from different places, that one of them might not arrive. And then what are you going to do? You have like a quarter of a gift, right? You know, you don't have everything you need. So this is where we want to pull, you know, pulling it together and shopping, that's a lot safer choice for them. So paying a little bit extra to make sure everything is going to be together and work together. That's a great idea.
And Amazon's going to tell you what those are, because if you go to the detail page, there's always frequently bought together right below the bullet, you know, look at that. So if that's a product, it's a great idea for development of a second product in your brand.
Right.
You could get something in that same genre. It's no brainer. Do it.
Right. So let's say, go back to your copper mugs idea, right? So you were searching the copper mugs, and copper mugs have a great spike. So, you know, what might the drinks be that you're doing copper mugs? So if you were able to then bundle like pre-packaged cider, you know, powder, people have that, you know, mulled cider and cinnamon sticks or something, and just put that together and make it a bundle, then all of a sudden you just improved your ability to sell even more copper mugs than the other people. So
and like you said, packaging is huge. So I'm going to go off of like a crafty thing, but you know, putting it in cellophane and tying a bow on it, it's like, okay, boom,
I'm done.
Product. Now what you've done is not only sold the product, but you've also increased your brand awareness that person might come back and buy more copper mugs for themselves.
That's right. They're like, that was really nice. I wish I bought it for myself. Or I'm going to put it on my wish list. That's what I do actually, is I like, I'm going to buy this for my sister and I'm going to put it on my wish list too.
So that happens. Learn that trick.
You got to do that. I wish list everything. Here's also another thing to think about. So a couple of other gift giving things that you may not be thinking about, but if your product is conducive to it, plan for it. Mm-hmm. At the end of the year, we have a problem as parents. We have teacher gifts. And sometimes there are like coaches, teacher gifts, hairstylist gifts. Like there's like a whole bunch of little gifts that go around to the people who service us, who just do so much for our kids and for us every year. And we're looking for something that's beyond just giving them a gift card or giving them a card, right? We want to give them something a little bit special. And so if you've got something that's, you know, on the inexpensive side, because you did, or that you could put into a multi-pack. So because I usually, when I choose something, I buy like the same one for all the teachers, for all the kids, right? And so, you know, you just kind of buy like a six pack of something, right? Exactly. So if you could multi-pack something so that they could get them that way, that's also a strategy and idea. And then make sure that you're tagging them that gift for teachers, because that's exactly the way people search for it.
Well, and more so off of Amazon, Pinterest. So when yes. I'm looking for inspiration, I usually go to Pinterest for the inspiration. Yeah. So don't forget to include Pinterest as part of your marketing strategy.
Right. And if you don't have the photos yet, there's great ways to create them. So yeah. I just did an interview with Adobe, and they've got this whole set of new like 2D to 3D. So if you have 2D skills in Adobe, so like Photoshop or Illustrator, if you've got skills there, or if your graphic designer does, they have this whole way of creating that in a 3D, so it looks better than a photograph. I could not tell the difference. So they were wow. taking generic product and putting labels on it, so like wine bottles and, you know, coffee cups and things, and it looked like it was printed and made and photographed. It was so good. And so, yeah, so there's a lot of ways to do stuff like that now. So you can find a designer who can help you with those things. So even if you have to recreate it or create it ahead of time and you don't have your product yet, it can be done.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so that's a great way. Also on Pinterest and Instagram and other places, you know, stuff hasn't come out yet. So they don't always know what's going to be new for this Christmas. So they are actually still looking at last year, the cool stuff that happened yet last year that they missed. Yeah. So even if it was your last year product, you should put it up again and tag it for 2018.
So, we had just as a side to that, last year we had, we buy out liquidations. And so we actually had a liquidation. That's not all we do, but one of our things we do was a cosmetic line. Walgreens went out of business. And so we took a lot of cosmetics and I put them in those little dollar felt Christmas stockings and then tied them in the clear cellophane with a little bow. And I did the imagery and I put a listing and I targeted it to girlfriend gifts, you know, stocking stuff, right. all that. And I didn't have to do any promotion of it, but stocking stuff for all those keywords to use. I made up, I think, like 3 dozen of them because I didn't want to put, it was fun for me. That's, you know, but we sold all of them. And I was like, well, look at there. So, I mean,
look at that. Yeah. So, I mean, people are out there looking for stuff. And so, yeah. and they're looking for ideas. And so when they see something nice, they go for it. Yeah. So these are some great ways to do that and think about that. So mm-hmm. we've covered so much, but predicting the season is really, it requires lots of planning, lots of researching, sometimes some history. Yeah. Any other advice you have, Brenda, from your experience to help our product launchers here?
You know, the thing I always go back to is don't be afraid just to do it. Fail forward, you know, so don't be afraid of the fourth quarter. Do the best that you can and jump in. You have to experience it once and then the next year will be better and better and better. So don't stall out. Don't be intimidated. Don't bury your head because you don't have all the answers. Just jump.
Absolutely. And so Brenda's here for you to answer questions, and she has her next office hours coming up in the next, I think, 3 weeks or something like that. You've got another one planned.
Like that, yeah.
Yeah. And so she's here. You can ask her those questions. You can always send her an email, check out her profile in the experts area of the platform. And these are just the kind of questions. So even if you get to October and you're like, panic, I need a consult with Brenda. She's here for you for that. So it is her busy season too, but she's here for you. So send her a message and get with her if you have questions. And, you know, a good thing for you guys to set up post-season is a post-mortem with Brenda. Because what did I do that went wrong and what could I do better next year? Because she has, I mean, you know, I was like, I know I didn't do as well as I could. I failed forward. I did something, but I could do better, but I'm not really sure what it is. So go over your numbers and bring the information and set up a consult with Brenda to talk about that, because that's a great topic for you to really be better so that you can capitalize on the opportunity and the learnings that happened for you over that fourth quarter for next year. So that 2019 is even better.
Yes. So. Yay.
So happy now, selling. Yeah, exactly. Happy selling. So I want to remind everyone that I've got another design trends coming up. So holiday design trends, which is different than the color trends, because we're going to talk about patterns and some things that you do different at the holiday season from design side of things, because it's gift giving. So you got to be thinking that way. And I've also got Timothy Bush is coming on to talk about inventory management and planning for mass market. So if your product's about to be in mass market for the first time, and this is a stressful plan, planning process, and it does start much earlier. So you really need to be thinking that through. And he's here to advise and tell you what's gone wrong, what's gone right. So that will be coming up later this week as well. So anyway, got all of these exciting things for seasonal planning, and we want to start early. So
we're here to support you.
We're here. Thank you so much, Product Launchers, and until next time.